Wednesday night Bible study. This is a special message for my brothers and sisters in Muslim countries who asked me to do a message for them in this lockdown. They cannot go and visit family, visit the churches, and I thought to do especially a message for the brothers and sisters who are suffering for the Lord in the Muslim countries. And these brothers and sisters are now being tempted by some of the Muslims who offer them food with the condition that they can take it once they repent from their Christianity, deny Jesus Christ and embrace Islam. And for them, I like to have a message from the scriptures, and we'll start in Proverbs chapter 18, and it's about safety. Before we do that, we like to talk a little bit about the suffering body of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the west of Europe, that is not so much a problem as it is in the communistic, Catholic, and Muslim countries. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 speaks about this suffering body, and it says that when one part of the body suffers, the whole body suffers with it. We read in verse 12 of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. A little further in verse 26, and whether one member suffereth, all the members suffer with all, with it. Or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular. Father, we do thank you, Lord, that will you have your words, and that there is a body of Christ over this whole earth, and consists of all those who repented of their own righteousness, and trusted the blood of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of their sins. And the gift of eternal life. We thank you and praise you for it. We ask your guidance and help and blessing now when we minister your words to those people who are suffering greatly as a member of Jesus Christ all over this world. And we pray that they be a blessing and encouragement and strengthen them to continue as they persevere in these tribulations for your sake in the true knowledge that one day they will be rewarded by you personally at the judgment seat of Jesus Christ, plus a 1,000-year reign with you on earth. Father, we ask your guidance and all we say and do in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. We'll talk a little bit about safety. And safety in the West, the last 70 years, is something a lot of people think is normal. Safety for many people in Asia, Africa, and South and Middle America is an extraordinary thing. And God promises safety to his children. In Proverbs chapter 18, verse 10, we read the following. The name, Proverbs 18, verse 10, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runneth into it and is safe. God's name is connected with a strong tower. Years ago, in about 1980, I was visiting Greece, and there is an area in Greece where there are monasteries built on very high rocks. I think this is Kalambaka, if I remember correctly. And it is in the north of Greece, and these monasteries were built there in the time when the Ottoman Turks were ruling Greece. And these monasteries were there to preserve the words of God. So there were very high rocks. And then on top of that, there was a monastery built. You could only get up when somebody put you in a basket. And with a rope, the basket was pulled and was pulled up. And as a tourist, it's pretty challenging to do that till you find out and look to the rope. And ask the question, when is that rope being replaced? And people say, well, you know, it's replaced when it breaks, and then it's time to get a new one. And that's not a very comforting thought if you're halfway. But that is not the case with a Christian. when a Christian comes to the living God through faith in Jesus Christ, he can know for sure he's kept, his soul is kept safe once and for all. It's not in his own power, it's in the power of God that his soul is kept. And that's a promise God gives a few times in the New Testament, especially after Jesus Christ died and rose from the dead. He promises the Holy Spirit forever in those and sealed till the rapture. Now, safety first is a very important thing if you are on a construction site, if you go walking here in the mountains, in the Alps. The first thing is safety. The first thing never to do is go out on a hike alone. You always go with somebody. Now, today with the cell phones and so forth, that may be a little easier. But in the old days, you never went alone. You always had red socks or red shoestrings in case you fell down. At least they could find, they can see your red stuff in the snow. And never, especially when there's not good weather, go alone. You always went together. And that's basically what it is with Jesus Christ. Whenever you go and follow Jesus Christ, he goes ahead of you. The worst thing which can happen for a Christian if he loses his fellowship with Jesus Christ, that means he either goes ahead of Jesus Christ, he can't wait, or he's so backslidden he refuses to follow Jesus Christ. And in both cases, he has lost the fellowship with him. Now, in sports, and I played sports many a year, the great players in any sport are characterized by one thing. They're in there on the right time and the right place. That's all there is to it. Doesn't matter if you're named Michael Jordan or Wayne Gretzky in the hockey or Cruyff or Messi in the football area. The great players, not depending upon their technique or their mentality, are always right there when the team needs them most. And they make a decisive moves for a team. And that's what a Christian should do in his life. He should not go ahead of the Lord, not behind the Lord. He should just go step for step when Jesus Christ asked him to go. And go in his footsteps, as he says in 1 Peter chapter 2. Safety is one of man's major concerns and needs, but can anyone really obtain 100% assurance anywhere while he is on this earth? Well, the book says in Proverbs 18 verse 10, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous, in the Old Testament, is someone who does right, who keeps the commandments of God and believes in God, runneth into it and is safe. Now, it will be a reference to the Cell of Petra and the tribulation, where the Jews will be hidden by God from the devil for 3.5 years and fit manna from heaven. But a righteous person today is somebody who, as a sinner, has come to God and asked God for forgiveness, and has the blood of God's only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to be shed for his personal sins. When somebody trusts that person that Jesus Christ died in your place, was buried and rose again from the dead, and that he is resurrected for your righteousness, that person gets clothed with God's righteousness, and Jesus Christ is clothed with your sins. It's an exchange of your sins on the person, the body of Jesus Christ, and God's righteousness from Jesus Christ counted towards you. It's a very exclusive promise. When you're born again by faith in Jesus Christ, that is a very important thing, that God's safety is what he promises his children, especially those who are in very trying circumstances, in a lockdown where the government forbids you to work, he doesn't give you any loan or any credit or anything, and people of another faith offer your children and your wife some food on the condition they convert to that other religion, which is not a religion of the living God. Now, first, I want to talk a little bit about safety in time of pestilence and plague. We know in the tribulation, God will protect his people. And those who take the mark of the beast after the rapture will be slain by leprosy, by a spot that goes in the clothing, in the body and in the house of an unbeliever or a backsliding person. The Bible says in Psalm 91, verse 10 and 11, Psalm 91, verse 10 and 11, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. Now that's a quote the devil uses in Matthew chapter 4 and Luke chapter 4, and takes something out. He omits four words from that verse 11. And the reason is that the devil can misuse scripture, and God watches how you deal with it when the devil does that. A lot of cults today, Seventh-day Adventists, Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, a lot of charismatics too, they omit verses, they add verses, as Catholics do, or they change the meaning of a verse by taking it out of context. But here we see in the time of a plague that God promises that no evil shall befall thee. He, in the time of Elijah, when Ahab was chasing him, he had birds feeding Elijah. He had him sent to a brook where he could get fresh water. He had him sent to certain women who could bake cakes for him. God always uses the person you will not reckon with. I've seen many times when I went as a young Christian hitchhiking and with no money, and the reason being is I want to see if the promise of God in Matthew 10 was true. That's that verse where it says, don't take gold or silver in your purse. It doesn't say don't take any purse. It doesn't say don't take gold or silver in your purse. So if you take your purse and you do what God tells you to do, and you preach what God wants you to preach, he will fill that purse. And I see that many a time. I was just saved for maybe 1 year or 2 years, and when hitchhiking all over Europe, and on purpose I didn't take no money with me. I said, I want to find out if the verse is true. And I found out the verse works. Now, I was in the wrong dispensation. It was before the cross. It was in the Old Testament, and so forth and so on. Maybe that's something for the second point, that God gives you safety when you travel. If you go where God wants you to go, and you do what he wants you to do and preach what you want him to preach, he will take care of you, not only of yourself, but also of your family. The Bible says in Psalm 121, verse 8. 121, verse 8. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Now, if you have to travel in this time of the plague, of this time of trouble, and you say, what about my wife and my kids? Can I take them with me? Maybe not, I leave behind. Maybe I should take them. You do what God tells you to do, and he will take care of you. I've seen it so many times. When you go by faith, and that's what is lacking in the last days, men who go by faith, and not by sight, God will take care of you. He has somebody else on the other side waiting for you. And the devil has somebody else though waiting for you, amen? You have to have a little discernment who is who and who is on whose side. But there is always safety in travel. And on the moment you go and you do God's things, God's way, you are entitled to whatever God wants you to have. It can be food, it can be drinks, it can be fellowship. It can be encouragement, it can be money, it can be all kinds of things. And I tell you, young man, if you look for a challenge, here's the challenge. You do what God wants you to do without making any needs known, and do the roughest thing with the proper text, the proper Bible, sound doctrine, the pure gospel, and you just watch God move. And I guarantee you, it will not be a boring ride. I hate the word exciting. But it certainly will not be boring. It'll be more exciting. I guarantee you that. And the biggest challenge, or the biggest temptation, I would say, is when you start to cut corners because you cannot wait on the Lord. Saul did that. Saul could not wait on the Lord, and he couldn't wait until Samuel would come and sacrifice. So he took the office of the priest, usurped it, and sacrificed. And then Samuel came. He's the type of the Antichrist. That's exactly what the Antichrist will do. in the temple in the great tribulation. And there is a man of sin today who calls himself the high priest, the Pontifex Maximus, the Septuagint Son of God. And he's put over a high religious system there, and that's wrong. If you wait on the Lord, you come back with Jesus Christ, that means you will once rule with him. On his time, not now, but later. You want to rule with him? Later, you have to submit yourself, humble yourself, and take up a cross daily. So God gives safety in time of travel, safe in time of the plague. We read in Psalm 91, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling, for he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. No plague. Martin Luther, the great reformer, was once in Wittenberg, the town where he ministered and had a university and a church, and he ministered there for over, 30 years. And once the pest was broke out, the Black Death, which killed over a third of the population in Europe in the 14th century, and the pest broke out in Wittenberg, and Martin Luther stayed. And he visited those who were plagued by that Black Death, ministered to them, prayed with them, and many people who died were ministered by Martin Luther. He didn't pick it up. God protected him in the time of the plague. God will protect you and your family in the time of this coronavirus. Now, you make sure you have a little distance of people. Don't stay too close or too long with certain people there. And pray. And God will take care of you. Now, God always promises safety in any situation, also in time of panic. There is, thanks to the news media, the fourth estate, which gets you killed, there is this so-called pandemic, which is the corona deal, I think, is less worse than the panic caused by the press in the last days. In Proverbs 1, verse 33, we read, "Whoso hearkeneth unto me shall dwell safely, and shall be quiet from fear of evil." That's a very important thing. You have to hearken unto me. You have to hearken unto the living God. It's here personified as wisdom, but wisdom personified is Jesus Christ. All the wisdom a man needs is to be found in the Lord Jesus Christ. And you will be quiet from fear of evil if you hear on him. The main thing is to keep your heart right with God. Jesus Christ said, "I leave you my peace. Not the peace of this world I give you." The main thing, what's important, is to keep God's peace in your heart. And don't be influenced too much by circumstances, or the news media, or the government. The government most of the time acts on that what the news media wants it to do. And nations, masses, are very easily manipulated by news media. The people in Athens had one thing, and the main thing they wanted to do is to hear and tell something news. Not that was if it was true, it was new. And that's what you see in the last days among Christians also. They want something new. A new preacher, a new gospel. I tell you, if it ain't the old gospel where Jesus Christ died on the cross, was buried and rose again from the dead, that an offer of sacrifice is once and for all, it's a false gospel. It's mixed with works, it's a false gospel. Works, it's false gospel. If you can lose your salvation, it's false. It's by grace through faith that you're saved. Now, the Bible says there's also safety in the time of need. Let's go to Psalm 37, verse 25. Now, some of you are in great need. You're in physical need, you're maybe social need, in spiritual need, physical need, material need, financial need, and God knows that. Look at Psalm 37, verse 25. "I have been young, and now am old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging for bread." You do right. You're not lazy. You're honest, and God will take care of you. It may be the last minute, but he will take care of you. Years ago, there was a man, and he was a German. He was a German playboy from Prussia. He got saved in Halle, Germany, the place where the first Bible society was in the world in the 18th century, printing the Luther Bible, and hundreds of thousands of small copies. By the way, the same place where the first missionary movement started from Germany via Denmark into the othermost part of the world by the Moravians, the descendants of the Waldensians, Bible-believing Baptists from the Middle Ages. And this guy, George Müller, got saved in Germany and had a burden for the Jews. And he went to London to work among the Jews. There were many Jews at that time living in London. But God directed his way in a different way. And he ended up in Bristol, in the northwest coast of England, pastoring a church, setting up a mission fund, and taking care of first a few hundred and then thousands of orphans. He never made a need known. He always gave his tithe. And God always provided in time of need. Once he was really burdened in the night because he knew there was no money, no food for these hundreds of orphans waiting for their food in the morning, so he started to pray. And God gave him peace. And in the morning, he came there and there was no money, there was no food, till somebody opened up the door. In front of the door, there were a bunch of sacks of flour to be used to bake bread, because the unsaved baker, in the middle of the night, got so burdened by the Holy Spirit that God told him, you go and bring a bunch of flour sacks to that orphanage for these orphans. In time of need. Now, we saw that many times with Elisha going to that widow of Sarepta, and she makes him these cakes, and the oil keeps on coming. It's the type of the Holy Spirit. You keep on doing what God wants you to do, He will take care of you. God gives you also safety in time of sleep. Now, some of you cannot sleep because you're so worried about the food, about your parents, about the health of yourself, of your children. The Bible says in Psalm 4, verse 8, I will both lay me down in peace and sleep, for thou, Lord, only makest me dwell in safety. You put all your burdens on the Lord, and He'll care for you. There's no reason to carry or worry for things you cannot handle yourself. Just ask them and give them to the Lord. And look upon these serious troublesome times as steps in faith God gives you to trust Him more. And the moment you trust Him more and put all your requests for the throne of God, start to praise Him and thank Him. You say, well, I haven't seen how He answered my prayer. God is pleased when you start to thank and praise Him, even if you have not seen what He does. But in faith, you can thank Him and praise Him. Look at 1 John chapter 5, verse 14 and 15, I think. 1 John chapter 5, verse 14 and 15. This is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He heareth us. If we know that He hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of Him. So once you know that God has answered your prayer, although you haven't seen it yet physically in front of your eyes, start to thank and praise Him. That's faith. Years ago, I talked about George Müller. He was a man who was asked, when he was about older, in his 70s, to travel around the world to preach the gospel, minister the word of God, and he did. One day he had to, I think it was in the United States of America, Newfoundland, the northeast coast, and he had to be here at a certain date in a certain time. And he was on the ship, and there was a huge mist between, a fog between the ship and the coast. So the captain said, I'm sorry, but we cannot go and land on the shore there, it's too dangerous. And Müller said, well, you have to go because I have an appointment. And he said, I'm going to go down and pray. Well, the captain was a Christian. So he said, well, you know, if this guy starts to pray, you know, I might as well pray too. So he came down too. And on the moment he came down, Müller came up from the ship. And he said, from the cabin, and he said, what are you doing here? He said, well, captain, I'm going to pray and ask the Lord to take care of the fog. And Müller said, I already prayed. And God heard my prayer. And the captain looked amused, because he knew that area very well. And he said, well, let's go up together. They went up together out of that cabin there, and the fog was gone. George Müller knew his father so well, whatever he prayed, God granted it to him. He didn't have to see it. He knew God would give it on his time. So God gives safety in in time of plagues, in panic, in time of need, in time of travel, and in time of sleep. He gives it his beloved in his sleep, the Bible says. And he gives also safety in time of war. The Bible says, I will both lay me down in peace and sleep, for thou, Lord, only makest me dwell in safety. And in time of war, the horse is prepared against the day of battle, but safety is of the Lord. Proverbs 21, verse 31. If you have to do something for the Lord, you have to let him fight. He'll fight for you and you'll be quiet, Exodus 14:14 says. And you go on his time and you speak up. And you go in and the Lord will take care of you. He puts his angels around you. Years ago there was a missionary who went in there and to the North African, the North American Indians. And these Indians came and shot at him. They were, by the way, set up by a Jesuit priest, De Smet, to attack any white Anglo-Saxon Protestant. Anyway, these men were all around there. They put a little circle of wagons, and they were hiding and shooting back. And suddenly these Indians, when they would come through, backed off. And years later, one of these WASPs talked to one of these Indians who got saved later and said, why did you back off? He could have killed us there. And he said, we saw a whole ground, a group of fire and men around you. As if it was a second army coming in to help you out there. And the man said, well, we didn't see anybody. He said, well, we saw it. There were angels there taking care of you. Well, the women were praying, but the men were fighting. And God answered that prayer. The enemy saw these angels. But finally, the Bible says there is safety from the last judgment. You don't have to be afraid. Once when Jesus Christ has taken the penalty for your sins, you don't have to be afraid for death. Some of you think, well, suppose I get this a virus, a coronavirus or another virus, what then? Well, then your body dies. And then your soul will leave your body. Two angels will be there to take that soul and either bring it to hell or bring it to heaven. And what you do with Jesus Christ depends where that soul goes. Now, Jesus Christ, his last words were, it is finished. The last words of Jesus Christ were that whatever he did to came to fulfill, he finished completely. That was paying completely the penalty for your sins you deserved. Now, my question to you is, what are you going to do with Jesus Christ? You're going to take him and ask him to save you right now, where you are, and bow your head and say, Lord Jesus Christ, I know I'm a sinner. I sinned against you. I ask forgiveness for my sins. Or you say, no, I trust my own righteousness, my own religion, whatever religion it is. And if you do that, indirectly you make God a liar, because you tell God, your son Jesus Christ is not the way, not the truth, not the life. I trust my own righteousness. That means when you die in your sins and you go to a place called hell. Now, for you who have been saved, if you're saved by faith in Jesus Christ, then I can only say, learn to trust him for everything. The Bible says in Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things, all these other things, will be added unto you as well. Also in a time of crisis, when there's no more food, no more water, ask the Lord, pray together, and ask the Lord to intervene in a miraculous way, and he will hear the voice of his children. And when you know he listened to you and heard you, start to praise him and thank him and worship him. He is worthy of all your trust, even if you haven't seen the answer to your prayers as of yet. May the Lord bless you.